Hello, welcome to the Gateway Church podcast. Liam Flint here, and this week we're talking all about worship. Now, I don't know an awful lot about worship, so to actually get in some pro help, I've got John Clark with me, who's one of the leaders here at Gateway Church. John, welcome to your podcast debut with Gateway Church.
Thanks, Liam. Really looking forward to it.
So we've got lots of wisdom there already, but to really complete our lineup, we've got in some external help. So really pleased to be able to welcome Simon Brading from Emmanuel Brighton. Simon, welcome, mate.
Hey, Liam. Thanks so much for having me here.
Absolute pleasure. So, title, Worshipping When You Don't Feel Like It. We'll just unpack this and talk through the bit of the bizarre season that we're in at the moment with all of us doing church online. Now, from my side of the fence, being part of a congregation, I'm just fascinated to, first of all, find out from you two as worship leaders, how have you guys found the last few months trying to lead a church in worship from your living room, trying to set up all the gear and equipment, actually doing it to a camera? Could you both just sum up, how have you found the last few months? Because I think a lot of us won't have a clue, really.
That's a good question. John, do you want to answer?
Well, I'll tell you what, I'll say what we do, and then Simon, you give us your pitch, because I mean, it does look very different. You look across different churches all doing so many different things, which I think is really good. Actually, there's no one way to approach this season, but what we are trying to do is to create that sense of community worshiping, and the real reason why we're doing it all hasn't changed. We're seeking to bring glory and honor to God, but how we're doing it is very different. Where we used to kind of early morning practices, getting ready for church on Sunday morning, it's now late night video edits and hours with recording software. And so in some ways, everything's changed, and also nothing has changed in that what we're trying to do in helping people to worship, trying to get different faces on screen, whether it be a virtual choir, different instruments, to have that sense of this is us as a church community gathered to worship. We have to do that in slightly different ways, but fundamentally it's the same. But it's very bizarre doing into a camera and not actually having people there, and really, really miss being able to worship with people in the same room. But yeah, many things similar, but also everything's changed.
Yeah, we've been on a real journey as Emmanuel. I think back in March for the first live stream, we just took what we would normally do in a service and just filmed it and put it out online. You know, churches have been live streaming for a few years, and there's lots of churches around the world with thousands of people tuning in every week. But one thing we noticed was, it's watching it back and watching on a Sunday morning from home, it's very different when the room is empty. The most live stream services people watch have got a whole crowd of worshippers and they're singing along, and you can hear the sound of plurality of a community. But an empty room, it doesn't translate the same way across screen as when there's people in it. And even what works in a room of just you and a guitar and singing for 20 minutes, actually across onto a screen, it just doesn't translate the same way. I think most churches are kind of realizing that preaching, what works in the room, when there's a physical person there present, you can do things that it's just different. It's a different medium. TV is a different medium. So what translates, what engages, it just feels different. So I think at first I'd sat on a piano and just led like a 25-minute worship time, which I think to some people, maybe maturer believers, it would create a great space for people to come and just draw near to God. I think for other people looking in, and you've got to remember, in times of crisis is when historically unsaved people would normally just show up in a church because they're asking deeper spiritual questions. But obviously they can't turn up to a church right now because no churches are open. So the only place they can go is to our live streams. So we've realized, we need to particularly calibrate our live streams so that our unsaved friends who are asking spiritual questions can tune in and just understand what's going on. They're not freaked out by it. So we actually changed the way we do our worship times to, I think, make it connect through the medium of TV. They're slightly less long, and just playing to the fact we haven't got a whole room full of worshippers here. We can't sort of go for that vibe. So if you look at our live stream at the moment, we do three songs on a Sunday, but they are actually split up a little bit. Now, on top of that, outside of that, we have like private Big Wednesday, which is our big prayer meeting. We have like 400 people on a Zoom call and like a longer worship time. Anna and I have been doing Friday night, like just songs of hope and worship for quite a few Fridays, which is just like an hour of singing. But yeah, as you can see, we've been on a journey in terms of the live stream thing. I think personally leading worship to a camera, it's fine, probably just because we've done a handful of YouTube stuff. I'm used to speaking to a lens and knowing behind this lens are lots and lots of people. And I think I've learned how to do that. It takes a good, you know, 5 or 6 times to sort of just get comfortable with it and know that you're not just speaking to an empty room. You are speaking to hundreds or thousands of people watching. So yeah, I haven't found that too unusual or unnatural, but I think probably just because we've done it a bit before with teaching stuff. Yeah, but I think just watching a live stream, knowing that this is going to lots of people in homes around Brighton, whatever, I found faith that while I'm singing these words, this isn't just me in a room, you know, the things I'm saying right now with my mouth, the stuff that's coming out, this is being heard by hundreds of people. I need to be a good pastor, I need to lead people to Jesus, and to help people through crisis. Yeah, so I think having the end medium in mind, this is lounges all over my city. I'm helping people find their way back to God, and helps me in that moment know what to say, and I'm not just on my own in a room. Yeah, that's probably it's a bit of a ramble.
No, that's really cool insight, because again, like from our side, we wouldn't necessarily see that. So it's great to just get both of your perspective on that. I think as like a churchgoer's perspective, one of the weirdest things has been that you can hear your own voice. So obviously for you guys, you know, you've got nice voices, so it's fine. But sat in our front room, if you're there with your wife and you're singing, suddenly you become, oh, hang on, nothing's masking me anymore. So I think even that, the confidence level, you've just got to go for it. And I've often talked about like going with the flow. Is it the same with you guys? I mean, you just mentioned, Simon, that things have changed from week to week and you've done a bit of live stream, bit of this. I mean, John, is that just part of it right now from week to week? We can't be too precious about this is what we're going to do. You know, things are changing, ideas will come, and it's okay for us to just change as we go, learn as we go.
Yeah, I think that's right. And being flexible according to what the situation needs and what the week needs, so that it's not necessarily always exactly the same, but being willing to go where you have, when you have musicians available, and sometimes not, just go with what you have. And again, digging back to what is the heart of what we're trying to do. And we want to get, as always, when we gather, we want to get the quality as high as possible, but also knowing that isn't the most important thing. But again, as Simon mentioned, there's real opportunity with people looking in. We're beaming into homes, not only of our church congregation, but of neighbors and colleagues, and thinking through their eyes, how can we help them to see the goodness of God through what we're doing, and think of different creative ways. So even doing the virtual choirs, as we've done, has been a brilliant way, because people can say, oh, I'm singing this Sunday, why don't you come along and check us out? And that's a brilliant way to get people in. And in all these situations where there's challenge, which we've had to overcome, there's also real opportunity for reaching out in that way, and also for us as musicians as well. Because when you're singing live, that's one thing, but when you listen to yourself recording back, there's nowhere to hide with those bum notes and everything. You listen back and you think, oh, I really hope I don't normally sound that bad. And it can be quite depressing at times. So it does give that opportunity to go again, and to really improve yourself, because it's so helpful to listen to yourself back and think, oh, that really wasn't as good as I thought it was. So yeah, the flexibility in that is really helpful.
Yeah, definitely.
So with worship being somewhat Holy Spirit led, responsive, normally you'd have people coming up giving contributions or giving words that you guys can then mesh in and come off the back of. Removing that, stripping it back, how does it stop just becoming a concert? So we'll sit down and we'll watch Simon singing like a little live lounge, or John and the band. Are you striving to keep this an engaging thing, even though actually you can't control what people are doing? Like, how do you guys do that?
You think about what a concert is. Often the difference is the people in the room deciding to sit on and watch or deciding to participate. You could have people on the stage doing the same thing.
Yeah.
So it's partly an audience thing. So I think how we try and stop people just sitting back and watching. I mean, we would encourage people, we're about to sing now together. I know that you'd normally be with hundreds of people. Why don't you just turn your TV up a bit louder, just help you just get in the mood and get in the vibe of it. I think at one time we did encourage people to stand up and sing, but I think it was a bit weird. I was like, actually, I don't want to do that. I just want to sit down and enjoy the song. When I'm hosting, so I in Emmanuel, I will sometimes host our live streams as well. I would always want to open up a song of worship with some faith to draw near to God right now in your room where you're at. The gospel is the curtains opened up. We can draw near to the holy places through the blood of Jesus, not just through the power of everyone being together, but you can do that at home. So I always want to lead people every week to Jesus and give them a sense of faith that they can spiritually this morning find their way back to the person of Jesus. They can enjoy his Holy Spirit in their lounge. And I think we have to remember that music isn't the mediator between you and coming to the throne. Our experience is when we do gathered church, that's often the most sort of powerful moments. Is when the music's playing and the songs are loud and everyone's really singing. That's where we can emotionally feel like, oh man. But emotion is different to the power of the Holy Spirit. We can connect with God through any part of the service as much powerfully through the preaching and through communion rather than just the singing. And it's really helped me just theologically realize, okay, we would normally have this half an hour time, this journey, this pilgrimage, where we'd all gather together, there'd not be a contribution in the word, we're going on a spiritual journey. I'm now trying to design our whole live stream, that hour, to be that journey. And yeah, there might be some songs, there'll be some stories, there'll be some scriptures, there'll be like a talk from the Bible, but all of that is leading people on this journey. Like all of these different contributions, if you like, are leading people to experience and draw near to God. So yeah, it's helped me. I think just theologically, it's not just about a contribution or music. Jesus is the mediator between us and the Father. And let's use all these different elements. You know, the principles of sing to the Lord, sing psalms and spiritual songs, and it's preaching and the word of Christ dwelling in us richly. All of these things are helping us draw near to him. So yeah, I think I've just, through the medium of TV, just trying to use our whole live stream as a way to move people closer to God.
Yes, that's really helpful. And also you mentioned about Liam, about Holy Spirit led, and it's important also I think to see the difference between Holy Spirit led and spontaneous. And at the moment we can't do the spontaneous so well. I mean, we're doing it all fully pre-recorded, we don't have any live stream element, and so we have no scope for the spontaneous. But again, it's really important we can be Holy Spirit led in terms of how we're preparing songs, which bits we're going to focus on, emphasize scripture we're reading. The preacher Simon so helpfully brought out that we need to think of worship not just in song, but it's throughout the meeting, it's throughout our lives, and we can be led by the Spirit. I mean, usually when, as worship leaders, we're preparing songs, we're kind of a number of days in advance thinking, praying, preparing, and it's the same for when we're recording for Sundays online. It's just we don't have that spontaneous element, which we can feed off. Maybe someone's brought a scripture on the in the meeting, but we can still be Holy Spirit led and praying for the Holy Spirit to be at work wherever people are as they're engaging with our meetings.
It sounds like there's so much positive stuff that I think on reflection, when we're back to some kind of normality, we'll still look back, and I'm sure you guys have already thought, I'm going to do this differently, or I've learned this. And actually, I think we're all working through that in our different areas of church life. And I just wanted to get your opinion on just the power of worship right now, especially when you look at something like the UK Blessing, which I know you've both seen probably to death by now. But just that just beautifully encapsulates for me the power of worship right now. I know we've said it's not just singing, but for that to go viral, we've seen countries around the world also doing that. There's something very special about music though, isn't there? Especially at this time for hope.
Oh, absolutely. And there is power. There's power, emotional power, the power in marrying truth to melody and rhythm, and it has a way of getting inside of you and touching you. it definitely has power. And that's why people tune in and watch worship videos. Worship videos are so popular on YouTube. Mm. Just people love being in a worship time, even if it's just a 5-minute clip. They love to just absorb and receive through it. So I think that's partly why Anna and I have done Friday night stuff just live, just because we want to just keep bringing music for people. Okay, we can't have a 40-minute prayer meeting or an hour prayer meeting on a Sunday or a Friday night all together. Well, let's still make a well that people can come and drink from together. So yeah, I think my encouragement to people, I've got other friends in the church who never really listened to Christian music. They've great walks with God and stuff, but now's the time they've really just started leaning into listening to a lot of Christian worship albums, which I think, yeah, there's a hunger and a thirst inside of us to sing and the corporate sound of worship together. So I think I just encourage you, if you're listening to this and watching it and you're not kind of actively listening to Christian written songs about God and the gospel, particularly live captured worship, I think lean back into some of that stuff now and just let God minister to you. It's safe to say this isn't normal. This isn't right. We're not supposed to be apart. This is not how God made us. That it's okay to struggle. It's okay that it feels wrong and it feels hard. So I think these are means of grace to us. If there's a great live album that you've really enjoyed and you've met God in, go back there. It's good. It reminds you of something of heaven, of being together.
Yeah, you said the word hard there, which I think does sum up a lot of where we're at. John, lots of people might be listening to this and saying, that's awesome. I completely believe what you're saying. But personally, for me right now, I don't want to worship because I've got relatives who are suffering or I'm isolated. You know, my relationships are breaking down. So lots of people might be thinking, I'm really struggling to worship now in my living room through a screen. As worship leaders, I mean, John, is there encouragement that you can give to people to find something in them that actually to worship through the pain will actually benefit them massively?
Yeah, I think so. I think that we all find, don't we, in this season, you have good days and bad days. Then there's times when you're just fed up of it all. And other times you're really excited by those opportunities and just the difference that there is in lockdown life. We've spoken already about some of the opportunities and benefits there are, but we do have to be real that there are many challenges. And also to give a context for lament and saying that this is really difficult. The Psalms are so helpful in this. I've come back to Psalm 42 a number of times, which is actually a psalm that speaks of a real longing to be with God's people and worshiping, which is so relevant now. But it says, "Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Saviour and my God." And throughout the Psalms, we see that it's so important for us to be real and say that it is difficult, it is hard, and then speak to ourselves and says, "Why, my soul, are you so downcast?" And to fix our eyes on the hope that we have in God, that he is our Saviour. This is a time to press into the truth that he is sovereign over all and sovereign over our circumstances. And we hold that, but we also hold the fact that it is hard. And so we need to speak to ourselves. You can find that in the mornings, can you speak to yourself, right, I need to get out of bed. I need to get on with the day, however tempting it may be just to pull the duvet back over your head and stay there for the rest of the day. We need to say, right, let's get on. Let's hold on to truth. And this is where songs are really helpful to connect with. This is the truth of who God is. This is who I am. And so we can keep digging into this day by day through the good times and the more difficult times.
Okay, preach it. I was going to say, Simon, anything to add? But I'm sure you're just going to go, yeah, what he said.
The Psalms are so helpful. They give a spectrum of human emotion. And the mistake that we sometimes make when we think about worship is that I don't feel like worshiping. Oh, well, just forget your issues. Just come and sing anyway. As if worship was just feeling positive and singing positive songs. The Psalms don't present that. They present people bringing their issues, their pain, their questions, their hurting, their longing to God. And that is worship. So if someone says to me, that's all good for you guys. I'm struggling, I'm suffering, I'm caring for my parents, whatever. I don't really feel like worshiping. Okay. And that pain, that suffering, what have you done with that? Have you brought that to God? Have you told him, like, God, this really hurts right now? No. Why not? That is worship. It's bringing the sense of longing, the hurt and pain to God. I think John Piper says we should give vent to the full spectrum of human emotion, and all of that is worship. And of course, that's what Jesus did. So the Book of Psalms is it journeys. You know, he would have done that when he was struggling. He would have brought the sense of pain and hurt and rejection to God. So I think when we've led people, whether it's been on the live stream, we've really dug into the Psalms. And the Psalms say things that often our songs don't. They go further in complaint, in honesty, than even some of our most honest songs do. So I think we do shortchange our people when we don't open up the Psalms for people. Now, you know, you could take that to the wrong extreme. You could start every, you know, service with just negative, come on, let's bring all our pain to God, let's bring our hurt to him. But so there's some wisdom in how we shepherd people. So I think we want to kind of catch both. It's drawing to God. It's saying, hey, you might be struggling right now. And I'd even read out a psalm, like a question. So it's okay to bring our honesty to God. And if you're hurting right now, good. Same here. It is hard. Let's bring that to him. He cares for you. So yeah, I just want to echo and continue what John said, really. We must use the psalms. We must help people understand that they should bring their honesty and pain to God. And that is worship.
Yeah, it's brilliant. And just on a practical level to finish, I'm aware that musical people, of course, they can start jamming, they can actually make their own worship, they understand all of these things that are open to them. But people who aren't musical, who are at home, what would you guys recommend? How can people make a worshipful environment for themselves? Is it YouTube playlists? Is it do it through song and dance? How would you say people, everybody can get involved? You don't have to be able to play a guitar to worship at home.
Yeah, well, first of all, check out Simon and Anna Friday nights. There you go.
There you go.
Good plug for that. I mean, there is loads of things out there to make the most of, such as what these guys are doing, and make the most of that. Again, I think one of the things you mentioned earlier, it's down to our heart for worship and make it a joyful noise to him. And so you don't need to be musically expert to use music to worship. So Vicky, my wife's been learning guitar while we've been in lockdown. She's not ready for being unleashed on an online Sunday just yet, but she's loving it, and she like will sit out in the garden, play the guitar and worship God through that. And so there is an opportunity in there to learn some music and just or even not use music at all, but just sing out. God loves our heart being poured out to him, whether we have great musical skill or not, none at all. The heart is what God's interested in that context. So I'd encourage everyone to be doing that, but also to have that big picture view of what worship is. And it's not just a few minutes on a Sunday morning where we're gathered to sing. It's all of our life, and seeing all of that as worship to him, living lives as a living sacrifice. To have that big picture view of what worship is, but also making the most of those many resources which are out there. Tom, do you have anything else to recommend or add?
Yeah, I think similar. The Bible is really clear. Like, we all have a voice. It's not whether you're a singer or not a singer. It's sing to the Lord and sing psalms, hymns, spiritual songs. Is Ephesians 5:19 and Colossians 3:16. It's to everyone. It's to the church. And so I wouldn't just be like, oh, I can't sing. Instruments help, but if you don't play an instrument, there's lots of playlists out there, worship playlists. There's lots of albums. Find one that you connect with and leads you to Jesus and takes you through the gospel, and sing along. I think also just to say, we mustn't just reduce worship to just singing, even just in your own just walk with the Lord, with that personal time with him. Try and carve that out if you aren't in the week, even in the day, getting a regular time where you can just sit down and relate to God, talk to him deep from your heart, pray to him, tell him your feelings, how you're doing deep down, be honest with him. That is an act of worship to him. And it might be you need to do that first before you just start singing. You just need to just talk, talk with him, hear his voice, and just love him again, enjoy his love again. And from that place, sometimes then a song will start to flow out. I have to do that sometimes. Most mornings I'll sit and read the Bible and talk with God a bit first before I'm in a place where I feel like, yeah, I can just jump on the piano now. So I just encourage you, don't be like, oh, I have to play an instrument, I have to sing. I think your general bringing your heart regularly to God, bringing your longing to Him, bringing your desires to Him, is an act of worship.
Yeah, wise words. Yeah, I hope listening to this, you felt encouraged to worship or whatever means you can, using your gifts, your skills. And it is, yeah, there's so much more we could talk about this. But yeah, Simon, thank you so much for your time. So good to catch up. And yeah,
thank
your
you
insight's
so much,
been really
man.
Valuable. Thank you.
Thank you, man. Thank you.